So let's begin by reviewing our basic structure of single-stranded DNA. And you may remember that in our example that we had gone over previously, we showed a tetrameric example consisting of four nucleotides joined together through phosphodiester bonds. And focusing in on, for example, the nucleotide that contains cytosine as its nitrogenous base, we see that cytosine is going to be linked to our ribose sugar. A ribose sugar has one, two, three, four, five carbons and an apex oxygen in the ribose ring here. And the cytosine nitrogenous base shown in red is linked to the ribose sugar through a glycosidic bond, which links a nitrogen of the nitrogenous base to the first carbon of the ribose sugar. And we'll illustrate that bond right now. So here is our glycosidic bond between our nitrogen of the nitrogenous base and the one prime carbon, the first carbon of the ribose sugar. And then if we focus in on the five prime carbon of the sugar, the fifth carbon, we see that it is linked through an oxygen to a phosphorus atom, shown in orange, which is then linked through an oxygen to the three prime carbon, the third carbon of the nucleotide in the chain above the nucleotide that we are now considering. So then what we see is that on either side of the phosphorus atom are two oxygens, and those are ester linkages. So we refer to the connections between nucleotides as phosphodiester linkages. Phosphodiester linkages. So here's the phospho, and there's the diester linkages. And you can see that it is those linkages that connect the nucleotides in a single strand of DNA. The nitrogenous bases are not linked to each other in any way except through the sugar phosphate backbone. And you will note that the sugar phosphate backbone has a polarity to it. And that is because if you follow the backbone through, you will see that, for example, in the example we're looking at here, here we have a three prime carbon, an oxygen, phosphorus, oxygen, five prime carbon, four prime carbon, three prime carbon, then down through another phosphorus to the five prime carbon. We are running in this direction. We are going five prime to three prime, and the end of this molecule ends in a three prime oxygen attached to the three prime carbon of this molecule. Likewise, the top of this molecule ends in a five prime phosphorus group attached to the five prime carbon of the initial nucleotide in this chain going top to bottom. And so we can view this single-stranded DNA then as a sugar phosphate backbone shown in purple with the nitrogenous bases linked through glycosidic bond to each ribose sugar in each nucleotide of the chain. But considering the structure now of double-stranded DNA, we can see that we'll color the strands of double-stranded DNA differentially here. The nitrogenous bases of one strand are in green and in the other cyan or aqua, and we can see the hydrogen bonds that connects the nitrogenous bases in the center of the molecule. And examining the polarity now of the two strands, we see that they are anti-parallel. One runs five prime to three prime top to bottom, and the other one runs three prime to five prime top to bottom. And you can see that by looking at the sugars of each chain. Here the apex oxygen points down, and here on the other strand, the apex oxygens of the ribose sugars point up. Again, anti-parallel polarities of the two strands of DNA. And the diameter of DNA, of B-DNA, which is the common form of DNA in cells, the diameter is 20 angstroms, an angstrom being 10 times 1 times 10 to the minus 10th meters. And the distance between base pairs is 3.4 angstroms. So we have a diameter of 20 angstroms and a distance between base pairs of 3.4 angstroms. And the pairing of the nitrogenous bases in the interior part of the helix are always adenine paired with thymine and guanine paired with cytosine. And there are hydrogen bonds that connect the AT base pairs and the GC base pairs. And we can see that illustrated here, and immediately noticeable, as discovered by Watson and Crick, and now confirmed, is that there are two hydrogen bonds that connect adenine and thymine, where there are three hydrogen bonds that connect guanine and cytosine. And we see the relevant hydrogen bond donors and acceptors in the appropriate hydrogen bond partners of the base pairs here. Now, the AT and GC base pairing results in strand complementarity, whereby one strand of DNA is complementary to the other strand. It's non-identical in that it is in opposite polarity, but it is also non-identical in that the bases on one strand are not the same as the bases on the other strand. Rather, they are complementary in a hydrogen bonding sense. So opposite an A, there is always a T, and opposite a G, shown in green, there is always a C, shown in red. And this complementarity provides the mechanism for DNA replication as discovered by Watson and Crick, as first mentioned by Watson and Crick in their seminal paper describing the structure of DNA. So this semi-conservative mode of replication is illustrated here. We'll eliminate one strand for illustrative purposes, and we can see that using one strand as a template, a new strand can be built up, inserting nucleotides which contain the appropriate hydrogen bonding partner nitrogenous bases that are complementary to the nitrogenous base on the template strand. So one strand will serve as a template, and another strand will be synthesized anew using the information present in the template strand to build a new strand in which the bases are complementary to those of the template strand. Now, if we look at DNA and look at the attachment of the bases to the sugar phosphate backbone, we see that they are asymmetrical. That is, that creates a groove on one side which is wider than a groove on the other side. So here is the minor groove, and here is the major groove of DNA, and that is because the attachment of the glycosidic, or the arrangement of the glycosidic bonds, which attaches the nitrogenous bases to the sugar phosphate backbone, is not equal. It is asymmetric, and you can see that by the bond angles illustrated here, which creates a situation whereby the distance between the phosphate backbones is shorter in the minor groove than in the major groove. And that means that the edges of the base pair in the major groove are more exposed than in the minor groove. So if you were a protein interacting with DNA, you would find that there's less area of the sides of the bases here to interact with, whereas the major groove affords a much greater opportunity to insert and interact with, in a stereochemical way, the atoms of the bases that are projecting into the major groove. And also, the major groove presents a more complex stereochemical environment for proteins that interact with DNA than does the minor groove. So let's look at that right now. Here we see the major groove. In this case, we have a methyl group attached, and looking at this TA base pair, we have a methyl group on this thymine, a hydrogen bond acceptor on this thymine, and then on the adenine we have a hydrogen bond donor and a hydrogen bond acceptor. So we have CH3, hydrogen bond acceptor, hydrogen bond donor, and acceptor. Whereas in the minor groove we have hydrogen bond acceptor, just a hydrogen atom on this carbon here, and a hydrogen bond acceptor. That is, in terms of the symmetry, we have symmetry of the atoms in the major groove that are available to be recognized by interacting proteins. Whereas in the major groove, there is a pronounced asymmetry. So if we were to switch this base pair so that T was on the left and, I'm sorry, so that A was on the left and T were on the right, in the minor groove, there would still be HA, H, HA. But in the major groove, we would have HA, HD, HA, and CH3 going left to right. So let's just imagine that we switched this base pair. And now we have HA, H, HA in the minor groove, but in the major groove, we have HA, HD, HA, and CH3. That is, a interacting protein would be able to recognize the difference between an AT base pair and a TA base pair in the major groove, but would have difficulty in doing so in the minor groove. And so what we these features of the major and minor grooves represent a situation whereby proteins that interact and bind to DNA by recognizing particular nucleotide sequences usually, but not always, bind into the major groove where there is more exposure of the bases, of the sides of the bases, and there's a more complex stereochemical environment that can be recognized in the major groove as compared to the minor groove. Now, the major and minor grooves lie 180 degrees opposite each other, so they spiral opposite each other up the double helix. We see that on one side we have the major groove, on the other side of the bases we have the minor groove. Here's a minor groove, and then here's a major groove, and those grooves spiral around each other as they move through this right-handed helix here. And that is easily observable when we illustrate the molecular surface of DNA. So here we're now illustrating the surface. You could see the major groove and the minor groove, and those rotate around as the helix proceed, as you proceed up the helix. So always opposite a major groove, on the 180 degrees opposite, is we rotate, there will be a minor groove at that position in the axis of the in that position of the long axis of the DNA. Minor groove, 180 degrees opposite, major groove. So that concludes our treatment of DNA structure for the time being. And as you can appreciate, the beauty of this molecule is really quite striking. It's an elegant molecule, has wonderful symmetry, and there's something very aesthetically pleasing about the form of the double helix that the human eye just seems to be drawn to. It's really quite a beautiful molecule. But at the same time, you will notice that in one sense, it's also a very monotonous molecule. The double helix goes on and on and on in the same shape for very, very long stretches, many hundreds and hundreds of thousands of base pairs in the case of a human chromosome, for example. Yet it does contain this monotonous molecule, although beautiful, somehow contains the information that allows it to replicate with great fidelity, and that allows it to encode the information of genes. It is able to store information in a chemical sense that can be decoded to produce an organism, to build an organism, and build an organism with efficiency and with repeatability. So how that happens is going to be we will be delving into over the next stretch of this class now, and we'll be looking at the ways that DNA information is coded and decoded.